Hi, it's Larry Hryb, Xbox's Major Nelson. Welcome to the show. Welcome to the podcast. Great to have you back. We were away for a few weeks, but the gang is back together again. Rebecca's back. Jeff is back. I'm back.
Hey. Rebecca's...
Hey.
I just felt like some restrained joy.
Right. Well, it's funny, Jeff, when Rebecca, you were away for a couple, where did you go? You were taking some personal time. Is that correct?
Yeah. You know, it's summer, so I wanted to do like the Europeans do and go on holiday. So I went to Europe with a bunch of my girlfriends. We just went to London, Paris, and the French Riviera, which is quite nice, very expensive.
But beautiful, I hear.
Yes, it was very nice. I don't know. There's some like very funny, like American things that happened on our trip, like just small things you don't really realize because it was the first time in Europe for a couple of my friends. Mm-hmm. I feel like most Americans don't think that, you know, when you go to Europe, the ground floor is like usually G or zero on the elevator. So then like we booked our Airbnb and it was on the first floor, which we're like, oh, that's great, because my friends brought really big, heavy bags. But turns out the first floor is actually the second floor. And
there was no elevator.
There's no elevator. So I got to help my friends lift their bags quite a few times on the trip, actually. Europe is not very elevator friendly. also just another like silly thing, but they charge you for water unless you specify that you want tap. Mm-hmm. And so like we had to like very specifically say like tap water and then not get charged for like still water. Anyway, it's like just kind of giggling.
Yeah.
That's what I need to learn.
That's a good question. We just kept saying tap, 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 as if the more we said it, the better chances are that they would understand.
Louder, understand.
Yeah.
I should ask my wife. Yeah. She knows French. I should ask my wife. I know Avetka Sus is water with air, with gas. Avetka Sus.
Oh, wow.
So that's all.
Well, you already sound better than the rest of us. So.
Well, good. Well. Welcome back. Looks like you got a little bit of sun there. You're looking very
sun-kissed. Thank you. Sun-kissed. Yeah, it was a great vacation, but it's nice to be back. There's, not a ton of news going on, but there is a lot of work going on the kind of behind the scenes. So it's good to jump back into it.
Yeah, we'll talk about that in just a little bit, but I figure we'll jump in about what we're playing. And Rebecca, I don't assume you had a lot to play because you were on holiday, but have you had a chance to pick up a controller or play something on your mobile?
Yeah, I did. So I got back on Sunday. So I had the last few days to kind of poke around. I've been catching up on some anime. I started watching Jujutsu Kaisen, which is really good. And then I started playing Ask Dusk Falls, which I really enjoyed. I played some of the Telltale games and I expected it to be really similar to that. And it felt a lot. I felt like the entertainment value is a lot higher than in the Telltale games. Like yep. It really feels like you're watching a movie as opposed to just kind of making choices, watching a cutscene, making another choice, watching a cutscene.
Without spoilers, how far did you get?
I'm not that far. I'm just at the point where like the guys... Wait, yeah, it's not a spoiler. The guys are, I'm not that far. The guys are like robbing the house. It's still like pretty early on.
Okay.
But it's been pretty good so far. But have you guys been playing much?
First of all, are you playing with your roommate? Because I know your roommate doesn't really play games, but they, you can download the app and you guys can kind of do it together. Are you trying that yet?
Not yet. So I just started it in single player, but can you have someone jump in when you've already started the... Yeah,
well, that's very cool. You kind of need to go back and tell it you're doing it, but yeah, you don't have to like start all the way at the beginning, just at like the previous checkpoint.
Cool.
Try that.
I don't know. What about you guys? Have you finished it?
I did. I finished it. I think while you were gone, I finished it. And Jeff and I talked about it extensively one of the previous shows. Yeah, I thoroughly enjoyed it. And Jeff, I don't know how far you are. You haven't told me lately.
I haven't gotten to finish it. Well, here's the thing. When you start playing with somebody and they don't have time for you afterwards, then at what point do you just say, I'm going on without you? I'm definitely like wavering there. So I've been playing other stuff because my wife just keeps finding new things to watch on Netflix, but...
It's like how we talked about Netflix cheating.
That's exactly what it is.
A couple weeks ago. It's like, oh, you went ahead without me? What the heck?
Yeah. Well, it's a little more obvious. It's a little more obvious in gameplay, though, because, you know, if you sit down with somebody that you're playing and you boot it up and you're at like a different save point, you're like, you're kind of caught red-handed. So...
Yeah, I could be like, you don't want to make that choice. Yeah, don't ask me how I know.
Yeah, so
just watching a stream.
So yeah, I've been playing that. Actually, I'm looking at what I'm Sea of Thieves. I've been playing that. I'm looking at what I've got here.
New season 7.
New season 7.
Yeah, your ship.
Did you name your ship, Larry?
Yeah.
I have not, but I think I think
isn't
I'm gonna
bad luck or something.
No, well, that's the new feature in the game.
it's now bad luck if you don't name your ship.
Yeah, it's
now that you have the ability to do so.
But I do have a name that I'll talk to you off the air because I don't really want to say it publicly. It's clean. Ooh. My daughter's name is very oceanic, so it's a play on that.
Gotcha.
So it's a play on that. So
this makes sense.
Yeah. So that's so
Life Preserver Herb. It's an interesting name, but you know what?
An interesting time. I kind of knew this was going to happen. But I asked Twitter what I should name my boat, and then it was a very R-rated thread.
That always goes well.
Boop, sideways. So that I didn't do that. But I'm playing, I'm playing Kill It With Fire, Turbo Golf Race.
What made you jump back into that one?
That's the spider killing game, right? I was going through, and it's cloud enabled, so I just didn't have to do the install. I just started playing it. The other one was Turbo Golf Racing, is essentially Rocket League with golf clubs and a hole in a ball. So it's you know, you basically have to push the ball. It's kind of, well, there's no golf clubs.
Instead of car soccer, it's car golf, right?
Yeah, exactly. So I've been playing that, and that's available on Xbox Game Pass as well. So check that out. So that's kind of what I've been spending my time, still going into Halo and just kind of popping that up every once in a while. Jeff, you and I have been talking about, you know, Jeff and I were just talking a few days ago about, you know, hey, we should play something. We're like, oh, what are we going to play? We're looking for that next multiplayer itch to scratch, as it were.
So I did play one multiplayer game without you.
Which play?
Apologetically. But now one of my games of the year of 2012. Ooh, full screen.
Yeah.
Escape Academy. So Escape Academy is it's a game that is a series of escape rooms designed by people who make real life escape rooms, but things that you wouldn't do in a real life escape room, such as fill it with water, and if you don't escape, you die. That's probably more fun.
You can get a little more aggressive in the virtual world of a VR.
Yeah, or like maybe poisoning one of the people and the escape
gas coming in.
Fixing. Yeah, there's one with gas. There's a number of ways in which this academy would not meet modern standards for student safety, but at the same time, super fun, very close to 1K-ing the game. So I played with my daughter, sort of found out, like, you sort of see that part where age versus, you know, experience, where it's like, wow, you're really fast. Tell me how you did that really quick. And it's like, you know, afterwards. But then other times, stuff where I'm like, oh, here's how I figured this out. So it was a good combination of us, her being just turning 13. Thank you, motorist in New York. And that one squeaked through. And you know, the differences in age actually helped us solve different problems different ways. So thoroughly enjoyed it. We played it over the course of 2 or 3 days. We would play like 2 or 3 puzzles at a time. Each one ranges between about 15 or 20 minutes up to, I think, the last mission. They put 45 minutes on the clock. Some we finished with plenty of time to spare, and other one where my character would have died because they ingested poison. We had 40 seconds left on the clock when we finished it. So it ramps up the pressure, but not in a way that is like oppressive. And you just feel smart when you play that game. So this is another one I highly recommend you play with somebody else, because again, all you need is logic. You don't even need video game logic. You just need regular logic. Like, hey, what do you think is this? And how do we connect this to that? And how would you solve this puzzle? So now my daughter wants to go to a real life escape room.
Because we've done some together.
You should. There's so many in Seattle.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, we will. It's just, I was like, this game is great for two people. A real life escape room, a lot of times you need more than that to be able to do it.
Hold this, turn that. You will go over there and do this. And
exactly. And so
one person good at puzzles, words.
But you forgot the best part, Jeff, about Escape Academy.
which is?
It's on Game Pass.
Well, of course.
Larry. Cringe.
No, it's true, though, because it made it much easier for us to both check out. And so, yeah, by all means, I really recommend it. Definitely in the top five of the year for me. So,
wow.
Wait, Rebecca, so if like you... Sorry, I've been holding onto this question for a while. So if you fail to escape, do you watch your character like die?
Sorry, that was the end of the question. Especially graphic. it just is like you ran out of time, and then you get to try the puzzle again. It's very much a video game. We did not drown, and then of course at that point, well, we knew the first several steps to the puzzle, and so we just. The one that we failed, we were at the last thing that we needed to do, and we just sort of got stumped. But so we just jammed through the beginning part of the several, and they're usually multi-layered, multiple steps. They're really very intricately put together. And so at the end, then we had like 30 minutes to sit there and figure it out, and we did. Go on, Larry.
No, I have a question. Because I have not had a chance to play it yet, but I'm going to, because I'm going to be traveling for the next week, so I may do it, you know, on the cloud. Are some of the puzzles procedural? Like I know in the old days, like when you're playing a Splinter Cell, it's like here's the safe combination. And it's
a good question. I don't think that they are.
Okay,
but it is possible they could change the numbers in some of them. But but most of the puzzles, I feel like there's really only one way it could be done because it has you're looking at artwork, and that artwork indicates how you would rearrange something. So. Yeah, I you could cheat and spoil it. And there is a hint button. Anytime if you hit B, then it'll give you a hint. We tried to play with no hints. With it being B, we hit it by accident once or twice, and then we reset the level because we wanted straight A's because you get sort of a report card at the end.
I remember. You can, of course, replay them, right?
You can just replay it, yeah. Right. In fact, there's sort of hidden things in each map. So that's what we need to 1K the game, which very likely
we'll have
DLC coming. So, like, I got more of these puzzles. We're
more
all
room,
over it.
More
so,
rooms.
Definitely. I think between that and As Dust Falls, great games to bring in people who maybe are not huge gamers because, again, it's not all about, you got to aim perfectly or anything like that. You're using your logic or your opinion or whatever it might be to help solve this, and it could be really fun. It could be a good party game in that way.
All right. Good to know. Escape Academy on Game Pass. What else are you playing, Jeff?
Yeah, other than that, it's... While you're traveling the world, Rebecca, living the life that most of us wish we could, I was tackling backlog season, so I have like a huge pile of shame, like so many gamers do. But it's been really, satisfying to like jam through games that I hadn't beaten. So like I had been sitting on Miles Morales on my PS5 for like, I guess a year and a half now.
That's a long time.
I played through that over a course of a weekend. Insomniac is awesome. That was a great game.
Oh, Ted, I miss those guys.
Yeah. Yeah. Great folks. And you know, they're awesome. So that not much more I could say about that other than, it was good. And then Black Ops Cold War, Call of Duty. That was,
I saw you playing that.
Play through all that. They're very like well put together campaigns, and that particular story looked really interesting. In fact, I don't think there's like a higher budget sort of like in terms of like terms of quality soundtrack, in terms of like a first person type of adventure game, I guess, when I'm playing the campaign here. It's just like everything is like so top of the line and shiny and over the top. And incredibly over the top. So that one went, you know, again, Cold War era. So it's just kind of interesting to see. You know, how that plays out. There's a lot of stuff. It reminds me of like The Man from U.N.C.L.E. I don't know if you ever saw that movie. The remake, Larry.
Thank you. Not the black and white television version.
No. Because there's like a point with a mission that takes place in Berlin going back and forth, which was just kind of fun with that. So obviously.
The Cloak and Dagger days of like the Cold War and all of, you know, the Berlin Wall were very interesting, weren't they?
So if you like that sort of like fiction, that sort of spy Cold War stuff, this is like right up that alley in a very significant way.
There is a movie that one of my favorite movies over the past 10 years or so. It's called The Lives of Others. Have you ever heard of it?
No.
Sounds familiar.
It's about the Stasi, which is Stasi. I'm sure I'm mispronouncing it. It was the German, West German.
East German.
East German, like secret police who would monitor all the citizens. This is real. And this particular movie is, I believe it's fiction, but it's based on a lot of real part elements. And it's just, it's very, very interesting. So go Lives of Others. Go check it out. One of my favorites.
All right. And so completely last game I want to talk about, because we're going to be speaking with someone who made the game out this week on Game Pass, Two Point Campus. It is a simulation game, but like a very like sort of user-friendly, noob-friendly simulation game on, because when you hear simulation, so I'm just like, oh my God, this is going to be really hard, really demanding, really exacting. You're building a campus. It's very fun, lighthearted, very funny, a lot of British humor, and you get to build a campus. And something that sort of paralyzed me with like in sort of like too much choice, and I don't know what to do, is like this blank slate that sometimes you get in like an event in a simulation game or something. Like, I don't know what to build. In this, it's like, okay, in order to get to, it's level based, you have to build this campus, and in order to get a star, which allows you to move on to the next one, or you can go for 3 stars, you need to have 10 people graduate this course. You need to build this type of building. You need to have their happiness level at this. Okay, great. It gives me parameters, and then I can get in there and I can go real deep, or I can kind of like play it lightly. I just found it to be just like a very relaxing experience, which not all Sims are. So, highly recommend you try it out. Again, it's on Game Pass. If you thought this looks interesting, but sim games have intimidated me in the past, I really recommend checking out Two Point Campus.
Now, it's interesting because, you know, we talked a little bit about this, but, you know, Rebecca and I went to the same college, Syracuse University, and in vastly different eras. And I believe
I wasn't going to make that joke again.
No, but I'm just saying it'd be interesting because, by the way, I don't think we've ever talked about what dormitories were you in, or what residence halls were you in when you were there for the first couple of years?
Oh, I lived off campus.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah, okay. Sorry. So I didn't.
Okay, yes, the south of France coming at you. Got it. Okay. But I'm just saying it'd be interesting to see if you know, we can talk later about our campus experience, but it's to Jeff's point, when you listen to the interview, you'll hear about looking at student happiness and all the elements that go into, but what I didn't see in that game was what Rebecca and I did deal with all the time in upstate New York, which was snow, lake effect snow, and how that impacts your happiness or not.
Well, I didn't get that far.
Right.
So I played like the
covered areas and stuff. Yeah.
Yeah. But there are different like sort of biomes that these colleges take place in. And you do have to do things that sort of take advantage or defend against things that might be happening in those worlds. So I think there is a snowy area. It kind of looked a little Hogwartsy. So I think it might have been like a wizarding school.
Well, there was a couple of buildings on the Syracuse campus, right, Rebecca, that looked very Hogwartsy.
Yeah,
like the VPA building.
Everyone called it Hogwarts.
Yeah. So I went there before the books and movies, so I guess so. Anyway,
when you saw Harry Potter, you called it, you know, oh, that looks like, you know, Jones Hall.
So
yeah,
maybe you did.
Well, all right.
I mean, it sounds, I don't know. I mean, I guess, so is it like you have like a preset, like you have to have a cafeteria, you have to have like two academic buildings, like,
no, it's a great question.
Center.
So you start off with like an empty building. And so on the first level, and $250,000. And it's like, okay, well, first we need to build the lab, because you're building this is a science school.
Yeah.
And so you built, although like kind of a funny one though, you know, they're doing whatever they're doing. And then it's like, okay, you have your first 10 people enroll. These people need to go to the bathroom. These people need a place to sleep. Then at some point it's like, you could see like some of these people stink. It's like, we need to build showers. And then it's like, okay, well, the people are hungry. Okay, well, you know, let's put in some vending machines. And then later on, you have other options you can do. You can build a student union, and it'll let you know like what the people want. And then people will put in requests. Like at one point, like the students, they wanted in their dorm, they wanted a king size bed to stay together. And I was like, I'm going to need your parents' approval here. Okay. So, you can decline those requests. And so anyway,
it's denied.
it's It walks you along, but then you can go and you can just like make it aesthetically how you want. It's really user friendly. You can be like, I wish I put that bed one square over to make more room. Oh, you just hold down A, drag it over, drop it again. Or, oh, I want to make another one. Click on it, select copy, boom, it drops another one down.
Don't do so the interview, Jeff. Great job
of it. All right, I know I'm saying some of the things I said in the interview. So
I'm going to be honest. This whole thing is making me want to play Zoo Tycoon again too. Like these kinds of Sims are really fun, honestly.
Yeah.
I agree.
I think this is one of the easiest Sims to get into because I'm always one that's like, I'll always try it. And then if it overwhelms me with stuff early on, so I kind of just like, I just sort of shut it off. This one didn't. And not only that, but I would play it for like 45 minutes. I'd play for an hour, turn it off. And then later in the day, I'm like, I kind of want to go back and play it more.
And you did. That's a hallmark of a good game. That's a hallmark of a good game.
Exactly. Yep.
Yeah. All right. Well, we got to wrap that up. We got a little bit of news before we get into the interviews, of which Jeff teased it quite deeply there. So, Jeff, you got some news before we get us into the interviews?
Actually, Rebecca, you're going back to Europe, aren't you?
That's right.
Tell us why.
There's this little show called Gamescom that takes place every year in August in Cologne, Germany. Obviously, last year and the year prior, because of the pandemic, it didn't take place. But it is, I can't even express the scale of Gamescom as far as the number of people. Yeah. Like, do you guys have an estimate of the number of people who go?
Well,
it's over 100,000.
Yeah, I think it was 150 at the peak a few years ago. I think it was like 200,000 to 300,000, which, you know, just to give you an idea, I think at some point E3 maybe got 50. So
in 2019, and again, it's over the course of X amount of days, 370,000 visitors. That was 2018. I think it's going to be fewer people. They're restricting it somewhat this year.
Yeah.
But at its peak, we were there in 2018. Oh my God, it is. Yeah. There's nothing like it.
Yeah, I mean, it's one of our favorite shows because of the scope of it. And there's, you know, they've got such a great and the Germans have everything well designed. The halls are beautiful. They're wide, even though they're massive. And you're like, wow, these are really wide. You know, when you get there on Saturday, we're shoulder to shoulder. It is packed in there. So it is, it's a great show. But anyway, we're going to be there, right? Right, Rebecca?
Yes. I think this is our first real return to an in-person convention. Very exciting. But so we have a lot of exciting stuff that's going to be going on during the week. Most of it is on site. Like we have a booth for anyone who might be there. I think tickets are still available. We're going to be in Hall 8. We're going to have a lot of hands-on stations with games that were announced just, you know, earlier this year, August, 2 months ago, like Pentiment
earlier
is going to be
summer.
Earlier this summer. Yeah. We have Pentiment, Age of Empires 4, Flight Sim, Grounded. But we also have some really cool, like third party games, Plague Tale Requiem, Last Case of Benedict Fox. The reason I'm going is because Minecraft Legends is going to show some new stuff. That's fun. As much as I'll say. But I'm really excited because it's my first business trip, especially a business trip to Europe since the start of the pandemic. So I'm going to get to meet a lot of new coworkers from Mojang Studios in Sweden, going to kind of get back into that spirit. So I'm really excited.
Yeah. Well, it's going to be fun.
I'll have lots of stories to report on when I come back.
I have an assignment for you, Rebecca, because not only are there lots of things to play, as you mentioned, there's 36 stations, but you can, and I'm reading liberally here from Xbox Wire, come face-to-face with the first boss from Grounded, the Broodmother, a larger-than-life spider, 5 meters, that's 17 feet for you Americans, wide, who is looking forward to getting a selfie with you. So you can also walk the plank with Sea of Thieves. So it looks like there's going to be a lot of like sort of what in the business we call experiential things. But we're going to be streaming as well, aren't we?
Yeah.
Yeah, I think it's just on Thursday. It'll be in the morning Pacific time, more like the afternoon, evening for the folks in Europe. But we're going to be live streaming from the booth. So we don't have an actual like briefing or a showcase, event that we're going to be broadcasting this year. But we are going to still be pulling in a lot of our different developers who are going to be on site, talking about their news, sharing some other things that aren't being shared online otherwise.
Yep.
So, stay tuned to the Xbox social channels. We're going to be sharing a lot more around those in the days to come. We've got, from the time this airs, it'll be just under 2 weeks until then. The live stream from the booth is going to be on Thursday, August 25th. Maybe I'll try to like poke around in the background, see if you can see me.
Well, to your point, you know, as we just kind of alluded to, Jeff and I, we've gone in the past. We're not going this year. So if you go to Gamescom and you see Rebecca, you know, make sure you track her down and take a selfie if you're okay with that, Rebecca.
Oh no, that sounds terrible. No, I'm just kidding. Yes, of course, I would love to if anyone recognizes me. But I think I'll be mostly holed up in meetings. But yeah. I do want to like sneak out and try a few games. I'm really curious about Pentiment in particular, so I'd love to give that one a shot.
Well, have fun.
And if you are attending, don't just track down Rebecca, but you should join. There's an Xbox Fan Fest.
Oh, I missed those.
24th.
Are we going out on a boat?
It's at the Xbox booth, 8 to 10 p.m. Central European Standard Time. Gives fans a chance to beat the crowds and get access to the booth before it opens. You have to register at xbox.com/fanfest before August 15th. So time is running out. So if you're planning on going, xbox.com/fanfest, register. Don't just show up.
Rebecca, you should go to that. Like Jeff and I have gone to the ones in the past, and they are a blast. So if you find time in your schedule, make sure you drop by FanFest.
I will. There's one guy on our team, I think that we all know who I'm talking about, who always does FanFest. I think he still does FanFest, right? Yep. I'll send him a note. I'll see if I can sneak my way onto the invite list.
And you know who's going to be there is a good friend of ours and previous guest on the show. Graham Boyd, a friend of the show. That's right. He'll be out there as well. So I miss Graham. Lives in the Europe, and I haven't seen him in years, and I miss him. So say hello to him.
If he asks where Larry is, you just tell him Larry's on annual leave.
Yes, just that's the joke. That's a heck of a callback, Jeff. Anyway, Jeff, you got some news over there before we get into the interviews? I think you got a couple.
Right? So I wanted to just talk about.
Thank you,
games.
Rebecca. By the way.
So announced this week, Train Sim World 3. That's something that sounds like it would play very well at Gamescom. It's launching September 6th with Xbox Game Pass on console, PC, and cloud. So, if you like trains, this is definitely the game for you. And again, one of those things where it's like it's on Game Pass. So I think I might try it out, you know, now that I'm in a sim state of mind. Also out, actually, by the time you hear this, a lot of people have been talking about Cult of the Lamb. This is a game where you are in the role of a possessed lamb. Stay with me here. Saved from annihilation by an stranger. And now you must repay the debt by building a loyal following in their name. A lot of people were talking about this. I want to say at T3. But there's some that and a number of other games that are coming out this week. Arcade Paradise, Off-World Trading Company, Rumbleverse. That's another game people have been talking about, which is a free-to-play brawler royale. And so, you know, summertime's an interesting time to try out some games that maybe you've either haven't gotten to yet or to try some new genres. For me, I'm all about like experimenting as much as I can before Saints Row comes out later this month. Rebecca.
Yes. Brawler Royale, is that just a battle royale with hand-to-hand only?
That's how
I'm reading it. Sounds like.
Yes. It is. Basically you create a unique champion, which in the picture looks like a chicken, but it doesn't have to be a chicken. You get shot out of a cannon, you smash crates to find upgrades, you pick a fight and battle to the last. So there you go. Nice. Actually kind of sounds a little bit like very different look and feel, but Narika Blade Point is also a sort of a melee-based battle royale that is available on Xbox, and I had a good time with. Very different. It's almost sort of like a series of fighting games. Like you run into people, and then you get into sort of a one-on-one battle. But of course, there can be
it's like the old school kung fu movies,
stuff like that. Exactly. Yeah. So everyone,
just as long as it's better than the loading area in PUBG, where everyone needlessly punches each other over and over again,
or throws apples or what have you, right?
Yeah,
right. Same thing. Oh, fun.
Last but certainly not least, I did want to mention that Xbox is celebrating the Indigenous peoples of the world this week. This week on the 9th of August was International Day of the World's Indigenous People. There are a number of things we're doing. We invited a number of Indigenous artists to sort of create on top of the Xbox logo things that represent their particular group, their community, and they did amazing work. You can check that out over on Xbox Wire, which is news.xbox.com. We're also welcoming a number of indigenous creators from North America and from Australia to join us over on Twitch, twitch.tv/Xbox. They're going to be streaming all week. If you're hearing this on Friday, then when the show first drops, then you've missed a lot of it, but there is still Heosic is going to be streaming on Friday starting at 9:30 a.m. Pacific time. So definitely, help continue to welcome folks to our community. We know we have an amazing community. So join up, lend them your support, and, play along with us, because that's what we want to do. What do we say? When everyone plays,
we all win.
So yeah, that is the news.
This cool.
Like and subscribe, Larry.
Thank you. Got to get that in there. Rebecca, we've got got a couple interviews that Jeff and I did this week. Would you mind bringing us into those since you're now full screen?
Yeah, absolutely. Hello. All right. So we have Ben Huskins, who's the design director at Two Point for Two Point University. So that's the game that Jeff was chatting about earlier, where you're building a college campus. Sounds pretty neat. And then Larry interviewed Mike Chapman and Shelley Preston from Sea of Thieves. They're the creative director and the lead designer, respectively. Like we talked about earlier, there's new season out, lots of new content. So let's give it a listen.
As I've been talking about, I spent most of the weekend really enjoying Two Point Campus. And now it's time actually for me to learn a little bit about it. And who better to speak with than Ben Huskins, joining us from the UK. He is the design director at Two Point. Congratulations on launch this week, Ben.
Oh, thank you very much. Yeah, it's fantastic to actually get the game out there. It's brilliant.
It is brilliant. I've been having a really great time with Two Point Campus. I will say it's been a little bit of a stack of shame situation that I hadn't gotten to Two Point Hospital. You bailed me out by releasing a new game. But in the time that I spent several hours over the weekend with Two Point Campus, and I found that there are some really unique touches about the game, the way it controls everything. But I would love to ask from you, what do you think makes a Two Point sim unique?
Well, yeah, so we always try to put a bit of a twist on reality, right? I mean, when we were coming up with Campus, we knew we wanted to have certain elements that were going to be loosely based on the real world of education. But, really, it's all about being lighthearted and putting a bit of a silly twist on normal everyday life. We want things to be relatable and for people to have a bit of a reference point in reality. But it just has to kind of have that daft side to it. So it's just a little bit silly.
A lot of that humor really comes through with the radio stations that you're listening to, the things that are announced over the, what we in the US call the PA announce, just the sort of overhead speaker that you might hear on a campus, and some really funny stuff. But talk about just how that, the writing that goes into it, how much content is there, and just like the fun that you love to poke at, I think, just the experience of being in university.
Yeah. Well, I mean, there's hours and hours of radio content and the tannoy as well. We've really broadened it out, actually, from our previous game, Two Point Hospital, where we had Two Point Radio with the radio DJs there, and it felt like with Campus, there was this great opportunity to explore student radio. I think a lot of people, I mean, when I went to university, my housemates were in the student radio society, and it felt like, right, we should really do something about that. This is, these are people who have never been proper DJs before, and they want to be proper DJs. And so this is their first foray into that world. We spend a lot of time just thinking about how we can flesh out this world of Two Point County that we've established that the game's set in. And so actually trying to make it feel like it is a real place, albeit a very silly place. And so a lot of the writing for the radio just comes about from us chatting about, right, who are the celebrities in this world? What are the products that people buy? What are the snacks that everyone eats in this world? Cheesy gubbins, as it happens. And we try and make it feel like a cohesive place, but with everything having that twist on it. So it just has a certain charm to it. And we're really pleased with how the radios turned out and the tannoy as well, just these sort of school announcer type announcements that happen around the campus. They just gives you a bit of a feel for what's happening around your campus, but just with that silly edge to them.
Thanks for bailing me out there. I thought it was the word tannoy. I'd seen it written down. I wasn't sure if that was like a World War II-esque sort of term, yeah. Thank you very much. Look, I've been that college radio amateur. I've been that college TV person as well. And you definitely you nailed some of the lack of professionalism and lack of training that I had personally experienced at that time. So let's talk about controlling Two Point Campus. Now, the game's coming out on cloud console and PC. And for a sim game like this, you would expect, of course, a mouse and a keyboard is the best way to play. But I've been playing on console, and I was really impressed with how easy it was to control and just how natural it was. I really didn't have to think about it very much after just a few minutes with an Xbox controller. Can you talk about the work that went into optimizing what is traditionally maybe viewed as a PC format and how well it works for console?
Yeah, I mean, that was really important for us when we started Campus. You know, we had to think about both at the same time. You know, we couldn't consider one as being primary and one as being secondary. So we designed all of the menus and everything about how you place items and build rooms with controller in mind. And the good thing is with our previous game, Two Point Hospital, we kind of done it the hard way. We designed it for mouse keyboard on PC first. And then it was only after we released it on PC that we then adapted it to console and had to figure out how can we do this on a controller. But effectively, we did all of the hard work as part of putting Two Point Hospital on console and you know, figuring out the solutions to those problems. And so that meant when we started making Campus, we actually built the game from scratch, specifically with releasing on multiple platforms in mind. And that meant that we had a head start on figuring out, right, how do we want this to feel on a controller? How do we want it to feel on mouse and keyboard? And so we're just always thinking about keeping that feeling natural. And it is tricky with a simulation game because they tend to be all these different menus, but we just try and keep things as simple as possible and focus on what's the most important thing for you to be doing at any particular time. You know, a lot of the game really, when you're, you know, we try and keep you in the world as much as possible. And so really we just distill it down to, you know, how do I place items in the world? How do I build a room? How can I hire members of staff and pick them up and move them around? And you know, you can do a lot in the game just with that. So we just get that feeling right on a controller and then the whole game sort of follows from that.
Well, kudos to you because I found that I spent relatively little time in menus. It was very much, if I click on something, there was usually something I had in mind. And that was usually an option just hold down the A button and you'll be able to move this thing, or you'll be able to hire this person, or you'll be able to clean this up or add the duplicate feature was really good too as the school grows. And let's talk about that. How should I be thinking about the campus? Like what are, what makes for a good campus? Because I think you're constantly, like any good sim, you need to build for the ability for growth, but at the same time, you don't want to overspend early on. You can find yourself in a hole. So like what makes a good campus?
Yeah. For us, when we were thinking about what's involved in campus life, you've obviously got the academic side of a student's life, going to classes, doing assignments, like maybe having extra tuition with your teachers, that kind of thing. But we thought, you know, we don't want the whole game to be focused just on the academic side. Social life is a really important part of student life. And we were really keen with campus for the nurturing side of the game to be an important part of it, right? You're kind of, these are meant to be real little people who have their own personalities and they have their own wants and needs and dreams. And, you know, I think building an important campus is about giving them a good social life as well as a good academic life. So you need to be thinking not just about putting down the classrooms that they're going to need and the libraries and things like that. You need to be thinking about, right, they're going to need somewhere to live. They're going to need their dormitories. They're going to need, you know, a student lounge to hang out in when they've not got anything else to do. They're going to need bathrooms and showers, a student union bar to hang out in, maybe have some parties, go to a gig, that kind of thing. And you've got control over all of that. So really, you need to be thinking about, how do I keep my students happy? And then how do I allow them to learn when it's time to learn? And a game's really structured around the balance between those two elements. So you have to lay out your campus with that in mind.
What I thought was interesting, and not a lot of sims are able to do both of these things, but, you know, both the macro level of the entire university or college, and also being able to zoom in directly into an individual student and see, oh, they're failing. We need to sign them up for extra tutoring, or this teacher is burned out. Maybe we need to let them go on a break. So I think as we're looking at the footage, it's you know, easy to see the macro stuff. We're building a library, we're building a college. Can you talk a little bit about just the individuals, and we see the happiness rating here, and how we need to think about individual students?
Yeah. I mean, that was a really important thing for us, that we, with campus, we felt like we wanted you to be able to follow individual students around and see their journey through their time at university. And so even though you are growing your campus and you can end up with, you know, over 100 students, we give you that ability to focus in on those individuals. And we do try and make them individuals as well. They all have their own distinct personalities, and they have different character traits, as well as a unique appearance. And, you know, the different courses that you choose to run will attract different types of students, and they all have slightly different perks and personality quirks as well. And, you know, so we like this idea that by letting you follow a few individuals around, you get these nice little stories that emerge. You know, you see what you can do actually in the game is you can favorite some of your students. And then what happens is, well, it's really easy to find them for a start, but then you get little updates on how their life is going. You know, they went to a party, and oh, now they've just done their assignment and they've gone up from a C to a B, or they've joined the power nap club, for example. And so you just get these nice little stories happening as you're following these students around. You see them, maybe they become best friends with someone else who you were following around as well. And that it just gives you that nice sort of relatable feeling, that nice sense of, all right, this could almost be me when I was at school or college. This is something that I've experienced myself. Maybe not quite as silly, but...
Well, that's why I put a crazy taxi cabinet in there, because that was what I was playing when I was in college.
Exactly. I didn't do my assignments. I played Crazy Taxi instead. And through following those individual students around, you actually get a bit of a sense of, you know, what are the things I need to improve in the campus as a whole. So there's this quite nice balance between following some individuals and then the bigger picture of your, you know, 100 plus students and however many teachers and staff you've got.
So before I let you go, when I started zooming in on the individual folks, I noticed a lot of like really unique animations that when you're zoomed out, you don't see a lot of little details, things of that nature. What are some of the, I would say, small details that if you're not looking for, you would miss, that you're just particularly proud of that the team put in?
I do think, yeah, like each, there's all these different types of students that get attracted to the different courses that you can run. And some of them do have some, I mean, they've all got amazing animations. I love all of the animations in the game, but there's some nice little details. Like for example, if you're running the gastronomy course, where you've got these chef students that show up for the gastronomy course and they make giant pies and giant cheesecakes and things like that. And one of the perks of the chef students is that they can make food for other people. So when you run that course, they will actually help satisfy the hunger needs of other students on the campus. And you can see them walking up to other students every so often, and they'll just pull out a hot dog and pass it over to the other person, who throws it up in the air and gobbles it up. And there's some really nice little animations like that. I think that my other favorites are some of the dance animations. If you're running parties or put down the dance floors in your student bar. There's a huge number of different dance animations, and so you'll occasionally spot one that you've never seen before, and you think, yes, that's how I want to dance.
It's really a way for us to go back and relive our college years, and maybe in a way that was more fun or maybe more productive than the first time around. Yeah. So, Ben,
exactly.
I want to thank
good
you.
Old days.
Yeah, exactly. But maybe like better than they might have been. So, Ben, thank you so much. You all have designed a sim game that is, I would say, very human, very cozy, and not exceptionally stressful. You liberally use that pause button, which sometimes sim games, you're trying to think too many things in too many places. And so I found this game to be incredibly relaxing, and it kept drawing me back in. So amazing job. Congratulations on launch. And well, for those of you listening, no excuse not to try Two Point Campus. It's available on Game Pass for cloud, console, and PC. Check it out.
You can sail as captains of adventures and see if these season 7. Joining me today over there on the left is Mike Chapman. Mike, good to see you.
Great to see you, Larry. Thank you for having us back. It's great to be back.
You've been on a few times, but over to the right, we have a brand new player in the game, in our game at least, here in the podcast, Shelley Preston. Hi, Shelley.
Hi. How are you?
It's great to see you. Now tell us, I know Mike, we're going to get to you in a second because you've been on the show quite a few times. Shelley, tell us a little bit about what you do on Sea of Thieves and what you do there at Rare.
I'm a lead designer on Sea of Thieves. I've been on the Sea of Thieves team for right since it started as a tiny prototype. And I've been at Rare for, I think, 17 years as well. So
I think we
long
see some
time.
Of your previous projects on the wall behind you.
Yes, I did actually. I was in QA test on Viva Pinata. So yeah, I started out in QA and kind of moved into design over the years. So yeah, a long time. Rare fan as a youngster. And yeah, now I get to help bring the magic to people.
Well, there you go. Well, welcome to the show. I want to talk to you a little
bit about,
we're here to talk about season 7. Mike, kick us off. This is a big update. I mean, it feels like I'm saying that every time I have you on, but this is pretty significant because I know that both publicly and privately, I've been asking to name my ship forever. And that's part of this update. So tell us a little bit about the update.
You're not the only one, honestly. Captaincy is one of those Sea of Thieves features. It's one of those features that we were always going to do. It cuts right to the heart of what being in a world like Sea of Thieves is all about. Being a pirate in a fantastical world like Sea of Thieves. And it's probably the most community requested feature for anything we've done in Sea of Thieves. And I think you think about those pirate tropes, you know, Jack Sparrow, the Black Pearl, all of these famous ships, Blackbeard and the Queen Anne's Revenge. Pirates are synonymous with their ships and legendary pirates having legendary ships. So I think we've always completely understood, and we've been as passionate as our players about bringing this feature to Sea of Thieves. And I can't tell you how fulfilling it is, and I'm sure Shelley feels the same, in terms of bringing this feature to Sea of Thieves. Finally, people can set sail as a captain of adventure. And we're so proud of the fact that this allows you to continue your pirate journey. This is having a ship that reflects you and your legend. And it allows players to progress in all the huge number of ways that you can progress in Sea of Thieves. The game has got so rich since our original launch. There's so many things you can do in the game now. And doing captaincy at this point as part of the 7th season just made so much sense to us, because now you can be your captain. You can be the captain you've always wanted to be and have your ship reflect your play style with all the kind of wonderful decisions we've made around how alignments work in the game and how milestones track your every progress. And like, Shelley, do you want to talk a little bit about how alignments kind of add to the type of captain that you are in the game?
Absolutely. Yeah. So as Mike said, being a captain, being synonymous with your ship and creating that link, that heart between you and your ship, is something that players have wanted for a really long time. But we wanted to kind of go really all in and deeper on that emotional connection that players have with their ship. So the ship isn't just a vessel between the parts of your adventure. It's always been the heart of the crew, but now it can also be your home. It's the place that you can decorate in the way that you want to, that reflects your journey. And so alongside being able to name your ship and own your ship, we've brought in this new milestone system. And what this is a whole new way to progress within Sea of Thieves that's kind of uncapped. It will progress endlessly, but it allows you to show off your unique playstyle. So if you do a lot of gold hunting, then you'll be progressing in the gold seeker alignment. And that might mean that you unlock the framed golden picture of the gold hoarder that you can hang in Pride of Place. And it might mean that you get the kind of posh and upmarket looking captain's cabin decorations. If you're a pirate legend, maybe you go after the kind of ghostly green glowing decorations. But it all means how you've progressed on your journey is represented, you and your crew, because obviously your crew can come and bring their things aboard as well. And that goes right down from when you board somebody's ship and you're looking around their cabin, you're looking at the decorations they've got, you're looking at these little trinkets. As we said, you've got the pictures, you have these little trophies as well. So if you catch lots of ruby splashtails, you'll have the ruby splashtail plaque proudly displayed on the wall. And it also, though, even from a distance, if you're progressing within an alignment, so in one of these play styles, when I look through the spyglass and I spot your ship on the horizon, I'm going to see the name of your ship, who it's captained by, and the banner itself. You can change the style based on the alignments that you've progressed. So If you're a gold seeker, it will look like that, and you'll hear the little jingle of gold coins as well. And obviously you can use that to show how you want to be represented, and that may be true, or equally it may not be true as well. You may be really cutthroat, but you're showing yourself off as a as a friendly player in the world. You're just showing yourself off as a whimsical rogue, when actually you're more bloodthirsty than that.
I think that may be the name. So let's be clear, I haven't named my ship yet, and I put it out to Twitter, and I may be regretting that now. But I want to talk a little bit about the mechanics of this, because you talked about naming your ship as one part of it, and Shelley, you talked about the other parts. But up until this time, up until season 7, which is now available, it's a free update. I'd be texting some of my friends and say, okay, we'll meet you on at 8:00 tonight. You get the ship ready and start loading it up, and he or she would get the ship kind of designed, and But now, when you own a ship, it just automatically appears, and it's prepared, and it's exactly as you left it and you create it. So you don't have to recreate that specific color scheme or that livery each time, right? It's just kind of goes with you.
It's a continuation of your journey. And that sense of permanence was at the heart of what we created as well. That sense that it's a permanent marker of your progress within the world. And it goes with you on your adventures. So if you were in a fire last time, you know, maybe you went into the Devil's Roar and got set on fire by volcanoes. When you go back in the next time, you'll see charring on the hull and you'll see the damage marks, and it will be repaired for you and ready to be seaworthy again. Right. But you'll see those markers of your adventures, even the map markers that you left on. Maybe you were doing certain commendations and you'd marked off sea forts that you'd been to. They'll still be there next time, well as obviously your captain's voyages as well, which is a huge new inventory of voyages that you can undertake that save with you on the ship.
Now, one of the areas, one of the meta games that we always had at the end of a lovely Sea of Thieves session was the Viking funeral of our ship. So, which is basically where you light it on fire and you all stand at the end of the dock and watch her go to the bottom of the ocean. Yeah. How do you handle that now? Because if I own the ship, I certainly don't want to sink it. Tell us a little bit about how that component works, Mike.
You might want to think twice about doing that now. I think, well, you can absolutely still do that, and we would encourage players to still do that. But there's a big mindset shift here that we really want our players to embrace. And I think, to your kind of opening comments, Larry, this is a big update for us. This is a huge moment in Sea of Thieves. And I think if you break captaincy down and some of the features that Shelley's talked about there, it really changes the sandbox of Sea of Thieves and the way you think about your sessions. But I think most importantly, and the thing we're most proud of, is trying to inspire that emotional connection with a ship. You know, this is more than just a mode of transport, of traversing the Sea of Thieves world. Now, we want the ship to feel like a home.
Right.
And part of it feeling like a home is it's right there where I left it, in the state that I left it in. So with the name and the cosmetic choices, and those cosmetic choices probably complementing the name, this is a whole extension to your identity. So walking into the captain's cabin and seeing the way that you have uniquely chosen to customize it, and the pictures on the wall being a reflection of what you care about and what parts of Sea of Thieves that you love. So, you know, it's almost like, you know, you're letting people into your home and they're seeing what you're all about and what your legend is as a pirate. So it's really exciting as a feature list, but I think experiencing and living and breathing it, it's such a huge change. So when they do the Viking funeral and the ship slips below the waves, you know, your ship is going to come back and it will be repaired. Right. You know, it will be in a state of seaworthiness. It will all be planked up. But the hull is going to be in that same state where it'll be charred from the fire. Yeah. There'll be holes, like there'll be exterior kind of cosmetic damage. And are you happy with that? Do you want to role play the fact that your ship has these battle scars? Because those battle scars are now persistent. So I think some players will really revel in showing that off between sessions. Or are you so proud of your whole cosmetic, you want to go to the shipwright and use some in-game gold to refurbish the hull and make it look pristine again, make your ship look beautiful. So it's really that almost role play impact that captaincy brings in. That's an element we're so proud of.
And that'll also take place, obviously, with the Viking funeral, but more importantly, when that level 5 Reaper is behind me and destroying me and drops my vessel to the bottom of the ocean. It's the same kind of thing. It'll come back with those battle scars, I assume. Yeah.
Yeah,
absolutely. But even the bad luck.
Go on, Shelley.
So I was just going to say that even the bad luck that you have, there's an alignment called the ill-fated for all the bad things that can happen to you. You know, being in storms, sinking your ship being on fire, all of those things are tracked now as well. And if you want to unlock the kind of ill-fated stuff, maybe you're proud of the fact that we have really bad luck as a crew and all the terrible stuff always happens to us. So milestones are not just about things that are necessarily perceived as traditional progression. It's a flavor to how you want to represent yourself, further to Mike's point around the role play.
And this is we've been spending a lot of time talking about purchasing your ship and naming it and setting sail as your captain and so forth, but there's actually quite a bit of other elements to the game as well, right? I know you've got a new plunder pass, you've got some other elements, the sovereigns. Tell us about the sovereigns a little bit.
Yeah, I mean that the thought process there was really around what is the place of a captain in the Sea of Thieves world, and you know, captains should be the VIPs of the Sea of Thieves world. They are the rock stars of the world. So they're going to be spending more gold as part of, you know, making their ship look pristine and paying for the little bumps and scrapes that happen along their ship, purchasing the ship in the first place. But because of that, we want to bring in these set of conveniences. Whereas you're a captain, you can buy stocks straight from the shipwright and have those stocks delivered straight to your barrel.
Yes.
As Shelley said, you've got that bookcase on the ship that's full of all your captain's voyages. So beyond just your personal inventory of voyages, you've now got this bookcase of all your options across the various companies. So friends who play together can just chain these activities back to back and really choose the difficulty and the length of play. So if they've got, you know, like a short session they want to play that maybe they've got, you know, 45 minutes or, you know, half an hour, they can do a really short treasure hunt on demand, just selected from their captain's bookcase. Or if they want this trip around the world and they want to experience all aspects of treasure hunting, like the riddles, X marks a spot, the gold hoard of vault voyages, they can do a voyage that showcases all of that style of gameplay. So that's a really big convenience that we're bringing in. And of course, once you've found all that treasure, for example, when you're going back to the outpost, the sovereigns now have this new stall on the outpost where there's a huge mast so you can see it from a distance, so you clearly know where you need to go, and you can cash in all of your treasure there. There's a little lift and a harpoon so you can harpoon treasure straight off your deck, and the sovereigns will deal with all of the treasure that you bring to them. So really giving captains that convenience for how sovereigns fit into play. And the characters themselves there, we're really trying to integrate them into the storytelling of Sea of Thieves. So the sovereigns will certainly have a part to play in the future, and they might not be who they say they are. And they're certainly wanting to deal with captains for a reason.
Now,
seems a little bit too good to be true, doesn't it?
But a little bit too good to be true, a little bit. Yeah, yeah. We'll watch those. It's Pirate World after all.
Now, Shelley, you work on the design side of this thing, and you talked about working with Viva Pinata and so forth. Tell us how you and Shelley and the team, you know, really get inspired for piracy, because you've so, I mean, I don't know, no one was alive when pirates, you know, these types of pirates were around, but you feel like you captured it so well. yet you're landlocked in Birmingham. So I'm a little confused have we opened up a rare in the Caribbean that I'm unaware of that I need to go down and visit? No. Tell us about.
Wouldn't that be amazing?
Yeah. No, but can we? Seriously, can we
talk to somebody about that? But tell us about the inspiration. I mean, there's certainly no shortage of media out there that you can read, but it feels like this is such a unique twist and it has so much of the rare soul in it as well.
Yeah, I mean, I'll give my perspective and Shelley, you're going to have a perspective on this as well. And this is the question. This is one we're going to get so passionate about. I think, I mean, as you know, looking back through Rare's history, like pirates have always been there as a clear inspiration to the studio. So I think that's always lined up with Sea of Thieves. But I think it's also the type of pirates that we're talking about here. It's the fantasy of being a pirate. It's not the reality. It's not the dry historical version of what actually happened, which I'm sure would be quite shocking to so many people. It's the fantasy of having the freedom to explore this world and live that pirate dream. I think inspiration wise, and it's the reason why a pirate's life always made so much sense to us. You're really going back to Treasure Island and the original Pirates of the Caribbean attraction.
Yeah.
Back at Disneyland. And I think that version of pirates where, you know, when you ride that attraction, you're rooting for the pirates. You want to be the pirate. They've got the freedom. They're having all the laughs. And it's that wonderful vision of the pirate's life. And even for gamers that have been playing games for many years, something like Monkey Island as well. Monkey Island, you know, the humor and the tone of that world. And I think that those elements naturally as creators, you draw from those inspirations. And I think combining that with the spirit of Rare, you end up with something that feels quite unique. And it's that goofy, whimsical version of the pirate's life that just opens up so much creative flexibility and different tones that we can tap into. So yeah, it's been an incredible opportunity to build a game like this. I'm sure you've got a different perspective on it, Shelley.
Yeah, Shelley, love your perspective as well.
I think obviously all of the examples that you gave there, Mike, and the Gooners as well is a huge one. We all went to see that as a team. We kind of had a cinema and we went to see that right at the start of development. I think the thing with pirates is it's so universal in its potential kind of charm and playfulness. Like, it's something that children can play in the playground. It's something that's so clear as to, gives you this idea of what to do. Like, if I put a treasure map in your hand and a shovel, you kind of know like what you're supposed to do, or you have a compass or you have a lantern. It conjures up these role play scenarios so easily, but at the same time, it's got this massive scope, and particularly the way that we've looked at pirates in our version of pirates, where there's this grounded reality to it, but there's also this super fantastical layer with things like krakens and megalodons and kind of the Sea of the Damned and going to the Ferry of the Damned. And I think it just creates this incredible ability for us to be able to creatively serve all aspects of piracy that people love, like whether it's that slightly more down-to-earth version or whether it's the fantastical. It's like Mike always says it so well, which is, if you like pirates, there should be something in Sea of Thieves for you. And I think that's the game that we're all trying to create.
Well, I mean, well said. So look, we've got Sea of Thieves Season 7. It's available now on Game Pass. And Shelley, you talked about Pirate's Life, which was, for those of you that don't remember, was last year's, you announced the Pirate's Life, which is based on the Disney Pirates of the Caribbean intellectual property. It's an amazing, amazing universe that you've created. That's still available for free. Yeah. This update's available for free. The game is available as part of Xbox Game Pass on Xbox Series X and S and Xbox One. And it's also on Windows 10, Windows 11. It's on Steam. I mean, it's everywhere. You have millions of, what was your last number you revealed, Mike? Was it 20 million?
We've had over 30 million players.
30 million. Yeah, I mean, that's amazing.
Oh, yeah.
So it's...
Pinch me.
Yeah, it's right. Remember, I tell this story so many times, Mike. I remember when it was five people and we were in the room in conference room and we were playing that little wire figures, and I kept saying, what about the sharks? Yeah. And you put the shark in that, boy, did you. But anyway, Sea of Thieves Season 7 available now. There's so much. There's Captaincy. There's a new plunder pass. You have a Shipwright and Sovereigns update. You have the Emporium, which has expanded. There's so much to find out. So head over to Xbox, news.xbox.com or seaofthieves.com to check it out. We'll see you on the high seas. And I'm still looking for the name of my ship. Now, I have to ask, Mike, what did you name your ship? I'm going to ask you, Shelley. Mike?
I named mine the Golden Blade.
Okay. That's quite swish. Okay. Yeah. Shelley, what about
there's a reference there. Okay.
Well, I want to hear the why. You can't just hear the name without hearing the why. Why the Golden Blade?
No, I can't go into the why because I might be teasing for the future, so I'm not going to go into the why. I've said it now.
mine is called the Isabella. So my cat is called Bella, but you know, formal name that we never use is Isabella. And I think like it's that sense of all the way through, I use it as an example, all the way through development, as like whenever we would write in design documents or doing anything where we were showing a ship name, just to show that emotional connection that players can have to their ship and what it can mean. So had to be the Isabella setting sail for real.
I think I've come up with a couple. Both of them have inspired me, so I'm going to go work on that. But anyway, I'll let you guys go. Thanks so much for joining us today. It's always such a great to chat with you, Mike. Shelley, welcome to the show. Sea of Thieves Season 7, available now. Go check it out.
Thank you so much to our guests, Ben, Mike, and Shelley. And thank you, Larry and Jeff, for those great interviews.
Well, got you to learn about naming your ship and setting up your own university. So that's we try to educate people. We just try to keep them educated.
We're pushing people into the maritime industry.
Yeah, we are. So
can we also just say that it's the official recommendation of this show to not crowdsource the name of your boat?
Yes, thank you. I made that mistake. But if you'd like to share the name of your vessel, feel free to do that, but again, keep it clean. Feel free to let us know. We'd love to know what that is.
There one that was crowdsourced that was like Bodie McBoatface or something?
That was the one in Europe, and that's still the one they used in the trailer. So I'm not doing any McBoat anything. So, but all right, a couple side notes. As you heard just a few minutes ago, Rebecca's headed over to Gamescom, which is a couple weeks. So we're going to try to bring you in for the show next week. No show. I'm out on annual leave, so it's my turn to not be in the south of France. Like Jeff and I are going to work on our stacks of shame and what have you. But Jeff, you're not going to be here next week as well, correct? Or 2 weeks?
2 weeks from now. Yeah, I'm going to be on annual leave. Nowhere near. I'm going to be in the south of Santa Clara County. It's not quite.
I thought you were going to say South Philly. So
South Philly, at least it'd be a culinary so close. Destination. Yes.
But anyway, so we'll be out next week. Be back a couple weeks. We'll talk. We'll talk about Gamescom and so forth. Eventually, we're going to be in September and October, and we'll get back to our normal weekly cadence. But summers are a little bit crazy. But anyway, Rebecca, welcome back. Thanks for joining us this week. We'll see you in a couple weeks. Jeff, yes, you have something to say?
Wait, Jeff, sorry, I missed this earlier talking about Gamescom, but Jeff, what's your shirt that you're wearing?
Ah, yeah. Hey, a shirt that I got at Gamescom last time. This is
I remember that.
Cologne. That is the soccer team from Cologne that every year that we went to Gamescom, it was like, I'm going to be able to make it to a match. And then they almost always would be playing away that week. So they're my favorite Bundesliga team that I've never seen play live.
But you support. But you support. I do. So. It's good to know.
It's a nice touch.
All right, gang. If you want to find us on social, it's pretty straightforward. I'll put if you're watching us on YouTube or Spotify, that's where you find us. You can find me at Major Nelson. Jeff, you are?
Right there. Oh, at Jeff Rubenstein. We have audio.
Right. And then Rebecca, what about you?
I'm at Rebecca_YEUN. It's pronounced Yeun, but you could also just say Yoon if that's easier.
Or you can just, if you want to just look at me and the 5 or 9 people I'm following, each one of them are one of my, I follow each one of them. We can keep it that way. All right, gang. Jeff, we'll see you in September. Rebecca.
Oh my God.
Yeah, exactly. Rebecca, we will see you in a couple of weeks, and everybody have a great August. And if you're going to Gamescom, have fun and look out for Rebecca, and hopefully we'll see you at FanFest. Bye-bye, everybody.